So good morning to you all. I welcome you here for the 17th session on TOC. Our today's topic, as all of you know, is you have a hidden factory. Yes, you have it. I'm sure about it. Perhaps you are not aware of it, and hence you may not believe, you may not agree. Of course, I don't mean you are doing something illegal, some illegal production or something, and I've kept it hidden from the government or something. No, I don't really mean that. And yet, I claim that you really have a hidden factory. If I admit that you are really not doing something illegal, then why do I make such a statement that may perhaps offend you? You may perhaps be perplexed, confused, puzzled, baffled, mystified, bewildered, and wanting to know, why do I claim that you have a hidden factory? So today, we'll discuss that. I will unveil your hidden factory. It is all your creation and there's no hand of God in it. You know the story of hand of God, right? Perhaps you might have heard it. Let me quickly tell you. Yeah, okay, you know Maradona, the world famous number one football player. In one of the matches, he scored a goal and it was suspected that he'd use his hand. Okay, video replays did not show or it could not prove anything. So somebody asked him, did you use your hand? He said, it was God's hand, hand of God, not mine. So there is no hand of God in creating your hidden factory. It is your own creation. So now the question in front of me is that, how do I show you your hidden factory? Your factory is hidden and it's my job to show you. There is a traditional measure to unearth this hidden factory for which you have already paid for. So we'll look at that measure which claims to determine how big your hidden factory is. We'll explore it, we'll understand it, we'll evaluate it as to how good or bad it is. And finally, we'll look at it from TOC's point of view. So let me go into it immediately without you spending any more time. Let's open the door of your hidden factory and have a sneak peek into it. So here we go. So the door is, curtain is being unveiled and now you will see your hidden factory. So hidden factory, it is a parallel universe. It is a universe, it's as big as, universe in the sense of your limited factory. And it is often unknown to the senior management. What do you find in that? You find all kinds of shortcomings, delays, waste, duplicated efforts, and some workarounds. So what does it mean? Like, come on, this is something vague. So what does it mean? The hidden factory represents the untapped capacity your manufacturing plant has. It is the maximum amount of additional production that can be unlocked without additional capital investment or spending more operating expenses. So how a fully utilized hidden factory will look like, or how a fully utilized factory will look like, right? If you fully utilize it, it would be around the clock, there's a perfect production. You are manufacturing only good pieces, there are no defects. You are doing it as fast as possible with no downtime whatsoever. And every hour of every day, continuously you are producing good pieces very fast as possible without any downtime. That is how it will look if you are able to eliminate this hidden factory. Now, let us see what it is. You have all the time that is 24/7, assuming that you are running all the three shifts. Now, out of that, there's some time where you have not scheduled any production. Maybe you are running only one shift or two shifts, but if you have not scheduled some production, that is the production with schedule loss to your entire time that is available. No, then, okay, that we call it planned production time. Now, out of that time, there is what is called availability loss, meaning some machines are not available, or there is a breakdown, or some material is not available, or whatever. But during this time, you are not producing. So, what remains is your runtime, where you actually run your machines. Then, there is a performance loss. Well, what does it mean? That you are supposed to produce, say, n number of parts, but you are not able to produce so many. So, again, that reduces your production. So, that is what we call net runtime. And finally, there's a quality loss. You produce defective parts. Either you have to scrap them or you have to rework on them. And that is how all this lost time is your really real hidden factory. Now look at it, how big it is. It is, in most of the cases, it is bigger than your other factory, which is productive. So how big it is? I'm just showing you some picture and saying that this is bigger. But really, how big it is? Apparently, on the face of it, you say that, yes, there is some waste here and there. There are some quality issues. So we rework something or we scrap something. And whenever I ask you a question, why it is 2%, 3% of rework and 1% of scrap? There are some rejects and there are some warranty issues. So apparently, but this is very small, not big. Below that, the real hidden factor, this is also part which is hidden actually. You really don't know how much. But below that, the long cycle times, long setup times, lost sales, lost customer loyalty, late deliveries, excessive inventory. So all this put together is the size of your hidden factory. Right? Why do we even care? One may say, look, I'm getting orders, I'm producing, I'm delivering, I'm getting paid for it, I'm making reasonable profit. So why do I care? If we are able to leverage this hidden factory, if we are really able to leverage it, if we are really able to make good use of it, then we'll be able to increase throughput. And we don't spend a penny extra. We don't need to make more capital investment. We don't have to spend more operating expenses. And still, we can generate much more throughput. So that is why you need to care for it, because that is your goal. You want to make more and more money now as well as in the future. So how does it get created? A hidden factory is rarely the result of one problem. If there is one problem, maybe you can solve it. But it's a combination of several problems happening maybe in parallel or different points of time in different processes and so on and so forth. They are happening throughout your factory. You can't easily see them. Well, then you may say that if that is the case, is there a measure? How do I know, sitting in my office, in the factory, how do I know? And I want to know how much is the factor, how much of it is hidden, that is the extent and the broad areas where I can look at it, where I'm really losing my capacity. So is there any measure? Yes, there is a measure. And that measure for hidden factory is used very widely by the traditional manufacturing plants, and it is called overall equipment effectiveness or overall equipment efficiency. It is abbreviated as OEE. So in our today's discussion, I'll be using the term OEE because it is very easy to talk. Otherwise, overall equipment effectiveness is too mouthful for me. So this is the measure that is being used. This measure identifies the percentage of manufacturing time that is truly productive. An OEE score of 100% means you are manufacturing only good parts as fast as possible with no stop time at all. See, therefore, the OEE has become the gold standard for measuring manufacturing productivity across the world. It is the best practice for manufacturing. It is a key performance driver. Is that it has got that kind of importance. Many of you would want to know it, but wait. Many of you would already know it. If you are in manufacturing, if you have worked for a certain number of years, you would certainly know it. But I do not know, I'm not sure whether you have looked at it from TOC's angle. So wait for it, we'll be discussing even that. So in simple terms, what is an OEE? If I had to give a mathematical formula equation, OEE is the multiplication of three basic factors. One is availability, second is performance, and third is quality. Now let me not get into too much of details of the formula, because the objective is not to teach you the details of OEE, but to evaluate it after getting some basic concept of it. So it's a multiplication of these three factors, but we'll look at it, what is availability, what is performance, and what is quality. OEE is a measure of the utilization of a machine. So it is that important. It gives us an idea to what extent a machine is being utilized. OEE is the relation of the number of parts produced on a machine versus its theoretical capacity. You have some installed capacity, against that, how much is produced? So that is one of the output that is given by this OEE measure. Just to take a quick example, supposing your machine is able to produce say 100 parts per hour or whatever, or per day, and you have produced only 67. So it means your OEE, overall equipment effectiveness, is 67%. It is that small. Now it is just one part of it, it's not all. Now this means the 33 parts that could have been made were not made, and because of different losses. So those losses or those reasons could be many. We'll look at them. So the mathematical equation is availability into percentage availability into percentage performance into percentage quality. Now supposing, let's take a very simple example. If you are running at 70% availability, 70% performance, and 70% quality, what is the OEE? By simple, simple person will say, why everything is 70%? It is 70%. Well, you are talking about the average. Here we are not doing the average, we are doing it multiplication. So the OEE is 34.3%. Now you may get a good picture, 70% not bad, availability is 70%, performance is 70%, and quality is 70%, but your OEE and overall equipment efficiency is only 34%. Now think about the difference between 70% and 34%. Think about all the time that you are wasting, all the scrap that you are throwing away, and all the reworked items your employees are spending their limited time and energy on. So let's look at the reasons as to why OEE may not be 100%. Why? Why not? There are three broad classifications, three main reasons for capacity losses, and that leads to less than 100% OEE. One is availability that I talked about. Second is performance, and third is quality. Let's have a quick look at them. There are six big losses. They are arising out of the three that I pointed out. So availability loss is unplanned stops or planned stops, both put together. So there could be equipment failure, or you have stopped the machine to do some adjustment or to do the setup. So that time that you spend on unplanned stops or planned stops is taken as availability loss. So out of a shift of 8 hours, if you are doing setup for 1 hour, it means the availability loss is 1 hour. Performance loss is small stops and slow cycles. So there could be some minor stops before you change the product or something, or some idling somewhere. Or there's sometimes machine runs slowly. they run at reduced speed. So that is called performance loss. And third one is quality loss, that their product set rejects, that there are some defects, and there are some startup rejects. So that gives you reduced yield. We'll see them a little more in detail. And what remains out of this is your fully productive time, and that is your OE. So what is availability loss? Availability loss is essentially the time when your machine should run, but stand still. It should run, but it is not running, stand still. So this is your production downtime. Now it has two types. What is that? There is a planned stop. The equipment is scheduled for production, but it is not running because of some planned event. It could be changeover, it could be tooling adjustment, it could be cleaning, some breaks, something. But you have planned that during this time, the machine will not run. So that time reduces the availability. The second one is unplanned stops. Equipment is scheduled for production, but it is not running due to an unplanned event that happens. It could be some breakdown, some sudden unplanned maintenance that you are required to do, or the operator is just not there, or material is not there, or the upstream machine has not sent the material, or the material that you have, this machine has processed, has not been picked up, so there is no space, and so on. So availability loss consists of two things: planned stops and unplanned stops. Then there is a performance loss. Performance loss means that machines are not running at their maximum design speed, either because they experience some interruptions or they run slowly. Now, how to explain this? This is a very good, simple analogy. I hope most of you are aware of the Cricket T20. On that assumption, I'm just explaining that. See, in T20 match, you are there 20 overs bowled by each side, and then therefore 120 balls are bowled in each inning. So maximum runs that can be scored on a normal ball is 6 runs. I'm not taking into account no balls and whites and all that. So maximum runs that one can score per ball is 6 runs. So in 20 overs, that is in 120 balls, theoretically it is possible to score say 120 runs. And if a team scores, say, 360 runs, so your OE is 50%. And the fun part of it is that if you score, if your OE is 25%, that is 180, you think that this score is good enough. And you have seen matches where the side made some 140 runs and still won. But that is a part. But what in our manufacturing terms, we look at our best capacity versus how much we actually produce, and produce good parts. Instead of six or hitting a six, if you have hit a boundary, that is considered to be a loss of two runs in that ball. This is a funny example, but I think it will give you the concept. So the performance loss consists of two parts. One is micro stops and slow cycles. The equipment stops for every short period of time, for a very short period of time. Typically a minute or even less. And the stop is often resolved by the operator. Nobody even comes to know about it. Now, there could be some small misfit, so you just remove it and it does something. There could be some jam in the machine, so you just remove that jam. Or some setting was incorrect, so you just adjust the setting. Or some misalignment was there. Or there are some sensors and they are blocked, so you remove that. Those stops are small, but they are counted as performance loss. Then there are slow cycles. Equipment runs slower than the nameplate that it shows, that theoretical speed, the fastest speed. But many times it runs slower than that. So the examples for that is, equipment has become old, so time to time it runs a bit slowly, or you haven't maintained it properly, so it's not able to run at the usual speed. because some parts are required to be changed, but you have not changed. There's some scheduling issue, some human errors, or some material was bad, so it becomes slow. There could be several reasons. So performance loss has two things. One is micro stops, and second is the slow cycle. So because of that, you are not producing the amount of the quantity that you could otherwise theoretically produce. You cannot score 720 runs in 20 overs. It means that. What is quality loss? Quality loss is the proportion of products that don't meet the specified quality requirements. It has again two parts, one startup rejects and production rejects. So what is quality loss? The quality takes into account defects, including the parts that did rework. A quality score of 100% means there are no defects whatsoever, only good parts are being produced. So OE quality is similar to first pass yield. This term is quite popular in your manufacturing world. So there's no scrap, there's no rework, everything is going very smoothly. So how do we calculate quality percentage? Take a good count, good products without defects, divide by total number of products that you have produced. So as I said, there are two types of loss. Defects are produced from startup until stable production is reached. They can occur after any equipment startup. Initially, sometimes you have to throw away some initial production where the machine is starting up. It has to come to the proper speed or something, or proper stability. So commonly happens when you do the changeovers. There are suboptimal changeovers, a warm-up cycle. We call it, machine is getting warmed up. So few defective parts are produced, so you just remove them. Or some machines are inherently like that. When you start them, inherently they create some waste, before they start giving good production. Then there are production rejects. This is quite typical that everybody knows. The defects produced during stable, steady state production, including that, can be reworked. Some of them can be reworked. You can go back, make something. But we measure quality on the basis of right first time. Do it right the first time. You see the slogans, right? So it measures precisely that. So there could be several examples of small defect, some scratch here and there. So these are the production rejects. So quality rejects, the reasons are that wrong equipment setting, expired equipment not functioning smoothly, poor equipment, and there can be many reasons. These are the sum of the reasons. So what is visible to you is that the parts that you are delivering to the customer, good parts, perfect quality, everything is fit and fine. But under that, the hidden factory has lots of things, a workaround, shortcoming, hidden cost, duplicated effort, waste, delay, etc. So that hidden factory, your delivery is standing. This is very interesting. This is a flow chart of a manufacturing line. So there's input, put in some material, it goes to some operation, there could be some rework, some scrap, it goes to the next operation, there may be or may not be some rework or scrap, and finally, some good products come out. So you compare that with the input, you are given input of 100 units, good units are 90, so your yield is 90%. Which is actually not correct. Because when you do the rework and all that, when you find defects in between, each defect must be detected, must be repaired, must be placed back in the process. So this results in wasted time, wasted money, and wasted resources. That is your hidden factory. And this 90% is, this is what we say that, our hidden factory is only to that extent, but which is not correct. Is much more than that. Now, these are the three losses that I talked about. I can get into more details and more examples, and there are some formulae and all that. But idea is not to teach you that. Idea is to give you an overview of that and then evaluate together. Why I'm saying together? Well, I'm sure many of you are highly experienced on this, so you can add more value to it. So let us quickly have a recap. OE takes into account all losses, and OE score of 100% means you are manufacturing only good parts as fast as possible with no stop time. OE is calculated by multiplying three OE factors, that is availability percentage, multiplied by performance percentage, multiplied by quality percentage. So your availability percentage is 0.8881, that is 89%. Performance is 86%, and quality is 98%. You have about 75% of OE. Now, it will give you an impression that higher the OE is better. Any common man, normal person will think that my goal, my objective should be to achieve higher and higher OE over a period of time. Maybe. Most of the cases may be true. It may be true, but not always. Here is an example. Look at the OE of week 1, 85.1%. Look at the OE of week 2. It is 85.7%. So you have improved, right? So you think you have done a great job. Are you sure? Dig a little deeper. You will find that what you have improved is availability of your machines, and your quality has gone down from 99.5% to 95%. So 5% of rejection scrap. So is this better? Is this number of 85.7, is it better than 85.1? So you have to take the things with a pinch of salt. Just simply don't go by the numbers. Dig a little deeper to know what it is. So how accurate OE is, how accurate it can be? See, it is easy to understand, but it has some practical difficulties in measuring it. What are those difficulties? Maybe we can talk about that. So even if you have very good intention of arriving at the correct OE, many times it is flawed. It is not really accurate. It may not even be good enough. And the worst thing is that for many managers, the performance-based compensation is based on OE. And even if it is not, they like to brag about it. I say, you know, my OE of the set of machines that I have is 86.9% and yours is only 82.2%. So my performance is better than yours. Is that so? We don't know. But I can brag about it. But if my performance, if I basically compensation is paid on the basis of my OE, then there is a tendency to inflate the OEs. So let's see how it happens. Okay, I'm on good time, no problem. So all roads lead to higher OE. You know, I'm a smart factor in my life. I'm very smart. I look at, you know, what I'm measured on. I look at what my bosses expect me to do. They're measuring me on OE. I will do every possible thing to have higher OE. And not only me, the entire factory, everybody, including the lowest level worker, he gets his incentive on the basis of higher OE. So if that is the case, we all unite and do every possible thing to show, I'm saying to show high OE, not necessarily achieve, but to show. Well, sometimes, you know, we need to massage the numbers. It sometimes is not really a true statement, but numbers are massaged. Who will say how? Whenever you are using OE to evaluate a performance, be sure that the numbers will get flushed. As Dr. Goldratt said, tell me how you measure me and I'll tell you how I'll behave. Now, how I'll behave? Okay. I'll manipulate the basis on which you are evaluating the performance. Say, imagine I'm a worker and you want to set a standard time or the fastest time by a certain work. So you come there with a stopwatch and measure it. What do you think how I'll behave? I'll really be the fastest? Rather, I'll be the slowest. Why? Because that time you will hold against me. You will say, this is your fastest time. So you should always limit that or exceed it. And I know it is not practical. So I will somehow make you believe that it takes you so long. And once that standard is set, that basis is set, I'm better off. Because I can always perform better than that and get my incentive. So I can manipulate the performance. What else I do? So you tell me how you measure me. And I will tell you how I behave. If you measure me with the stopwatch, how much time I take and set my standard, I'll manipulate that itself. And I'll get more incentive. This is how I'll behave. I will manipulate the performance base. For OE purpose, we need to use the best possible speed that can be repeated. However, this is difficult to measure. How can you measure speed? At best, you may be able to measure the average speed. You know what is average? Average is not certainly the best, right? It is somewhere in the middle. Though it is not median, but it is somewhere in the middle. So, if you have used the average speed, it already includes some losses. So you may choose the best of the day when the production has been at its peak, which has very few stops and delays and defects and something. And you use that. Say that a good day would be 80% OE. So you should achieve that. So that itself is giving me 20% discount. So the number gets fudged. You tell me how you will measure me. I will tell you how I'll behave. I will want a lower base. Somehow I will drive you to fix a lower base so that I can always meet that expectation. And at times I can even exceed it. Yet there's another possibility that there's some huge outdated data. For example, some time ago it was measured and we came to the conclusion that this machine every hour can produce, say, 50 units. Now, meantime, some changes have happened, some improvements have happened, and now I'm able to produce 55 units per hour. But I will not change the base. I will say that base is good. So if there are some losses, if I waste some time, do something, I am covered. I am safe. You cannot say that I have slowed down. Also, the same machine may be able to produce different types of product, and the speed required for them could be different. How are you going to measure that? So again, you ask me only. I'm running the machine, so I will do enough massaging, enough buffering, so that I get a good incentive. So you tell me how you measure me. If you are going to measure me on number of parts produced per hour, I will manipulate that so that I am comfortable. I am never be labeled as inefficient person, and I can always get my incentives. I inflate OE by removing the losses due to availability from our OE calculation. For example, plant maintenance is a loss. But in most plants, plant maintenance is taken out of OE equation. Now, why it should be a part of OE equation, you may ask? Well, it is a plant maintenance, it is required, it has to be done. Well, you may be spending, say, 2 hours. But that does not mean that we cannot reduce that time. Right?
Mama, meeting.
Baba.
So you Baba. Cannot, if you leave it out, then what happens? That time, nobody pays any attention to reduce that time. And if you happen to reduce that time, I'll smartly use it to produce more, but I will not show you at that time was available. So again, my performance looks better. So that, if that is taken out of it, depending upon plan, it may give a 5% boost to my OE performance. So you tell me how you will measure me. I will tell you how I behave. If availability is one of your criteria, I am smart enough to manipulate that. I'll take out the plan maintenance time out of it. So my available time is already reduced. So even if there are some stops, I'm okay with that because somehow I'll manage it. See, there are breaks. There are lunch breaks. There are some tea breaks and other breaks. So what I will do, I'll smartly remove that time out of it. Now I know I can stagger the breaks. It's not necessarily that I have to switch off the machine. But I will show that during this time, we shut down the machine. So let us not put it inside. So let us remove it from my OEA calculation. So I get the lower base, right? But even during this time, what I do? I do stagger my workers. So they take turns for lunch or tea or whatever break that they want to take. And my production continues. But my availability time has been reduced. So in proportion with that, my performance is shown to be higher. Availability is higher. And I'm even smarter than this. What I do, you know, this will give me about 10% boost. Earlier, I got some 5% boost. Plus some other actions that I took that gave me some more boost. On the top of that, what I will do, since my machines are working, some parts will get produced, right? So it will inflate the number of parts that I produce in the lower time. So I look super efficient. So I do both the things. I reduce the availability base by removing these breaks. And I work during that breaks, produce something, and increase the number of parts produced. So if there are some other losses in production, still my OEE will look great. So you tell me how you measure me. If you measure me on availability, I will manipulate the availability in such a way that my measure looks good. In a similar way, I will miraculously turn unplanned breakdown into planned stops or changeovers and exclude it. I know every week there are some unplanned breakdowns somewhere in the factory. So I'll provide for that. And when I calculate my OE, I simply remove that. So that time we will not bring down my performance. So I'm that smart. I do that. Right? Also, I'll put people to work on overtime. Supposing I'm just running one shift and some overtime is required. I will do that. But I will not show that as availability, that time was available. But I'll take into account the parts produced during that time. So that is how I'll smartly cover my other losses so that you will never know my real OEE. What you will see is that I am performing far better than what you expect. You are measuring me in this manner. This is how I'll behave. Now, how do I manipulate the number of parts produced? They are fairly accurate. I just can't do it easily. So what do? I include the defective parts and count them as good parts. Don't show it as rework at all. I count them as good. And if the part is produced by some other process, anyway, it is not coming now. If for this process, it was good. And if the parts are rejected by the customer, if he finds the defect, the entire factory has not considered that as defect. So I look good. Even I can manipulate the quantity of good parts. So I can manipulate anything and everything. Because why do I do that? I'm not a ill-intentioned person. I don't want to. I don't like to cheat anybody. But you are measuring me on something. If I don't meet my measurement, my job is in danger. If not job, I will not get the incentive that I deserve. So I'm forced to do that because this is how you measure me. So these are the several things that we talked about. Setting up benchmark with stopwatch, we deliver the slowdown, we'll manipulate the base speed, not take into account the improvements and take the old data, and then we'll take the advantage of difficulty of measuring the time for product mix. We'll exclude availability losses like plant maintenance, Okay, I'll exclude the bricks from OE calculation. I'll stagger the bricks and still use that time to produce more, but I'll not show that. And I'll exclude unplanned maintenance also by showing that it was planned maintenance. And I will show defective parts and good parts. So these are some of the ways, they are not all the ways. I don't have expertise on fudging OE, but people gain that expertise as they do it, as they suffer from lower OE, and if they are measured on OE. No. I will do all this, and thus I will earn more incentives and bonuses. So tell me how you measure me, and I'll tell you how I will behave. So OE may be a great measure, I don't know. I'm a factory manager, I may be a foreman, I may be a worker. But if I measured on that, if my performance is evaluated on that, if my bonuses, my compensation is based on that, be sure I'll fudge it so that I do better. This is a very profound statement made by Ronald Coase. If you torture the data long enough, it will confess to anything. What we have done here, we have tortured the data. You know, in statistics, we talk about outliers and all that. So we remove that for some good reasons, of course. But what we have done is we have tortured the data to show that we have a great OE. So this is the profound statement that is being made. So be aware of that. That if you are using OE for whatever reasons, be aware that it can get fudged without your knowledge. If you are top management, you may not ever know about it. And if you are being evaluated on OE, you will like it or not, you will know it or not, over a period of time, it will get fudged. It will get manipulated. Okay, so that's fine. So what OE to expect? How much it should be like? If you are saying that, you know, people fudge it if we measure them on that, or if we evaluate their performance. Okay, we will not evaluate anybody's performance. But still, we know that from time to time, there are maintenance, there is breakdown, there are some quality issues, and various things. So what OE we should expect? Of course, the theoretical maximum should be 100%. You can't go beyond 100%, right? But there are some clients happily reporting OE is 105%. Somehow I don't understand. You know, some people say that I'm giving my 100%. I can understand, I can accept. But people say that I'm giving my 110%. I'm giving my 200%. How can you give from where? Similarly, OE is the maximum that you can do. So how can you exceed it? So the maximum can be 100%. It cannot be beyond that. Now we are trying to answer this question, what OE to expect. This may be the goal, ultimate goal or something that we want to achieve, but you can't go beyond this. In reality, OEs are usually measured in a way to put the OE in the range of 80 to 95%, regardless of the true performance of the process. Why? Why is the these numbers please the top management? They feel happy. And hence they get what they want. Even if you are not measuring my performance, you are not paying me incentives based on that. My top management has asked me to measure OE, and over a period of time, I learned that if it is between 80 to 95%, they are happy. So somehow I manipulate and show it that way. Okay, so you said fine. So what if we measure OE correctly? We'll do everything precisely, correctly. So how much it should be? You tell me. No, it's a very difficult question to answer, but let me share with you some information. The question is, how would these OEs look if they had been measured without manipulation? It is usually much less than the official 80 to 95% that is given. It can't be. Most processes in Western industry have a true OA in the range of 40 to 60%. Now, this is that low. It can be as low as 40. They are between that range and not more. Most processes, most factories in the Western Indus, they, when it is truly measured, correctly measured, it is in this range. Having OE of 30% or less are not uncommon. There are factories that have this. So what is the difference between the true 40 to 60% and 80 to 90%? The difference is not the performance, but it is your self-deception. You are deceiving, you are cheating yourself by showing it between 80 to 95% because it is considered to be not practical. I'm not saying it is not impossible because there is one example that I have where it is 85 to 90%. Toyota has this consistently. So it is possible, but it is so rare, so rare. So most companies have between 40 to 60. There are many companies which have even lower than that. So that is the reality that we have to face. Because if you start measuring in your factory and you get very low, you will get perturbed. Don't get perturbed. This is what the reality overall. However, there is no single number meant for all. So if you ask me to give me one number from today, I am going to measure OE of my factory. Tell me what should be that number. There is no one single number for all. See, you can progress towards a number and settle at some number, but nobody can ever give you one single number. So, what the OE is good for and what is not? Can I tell you? Of course I can. Why not? See, one thing that we need to understand is that the OE measure is something akin to the utilization of a machine. So we need to know. We should be aware of it. There's nothing wrong in wanting to know that. So higher the OE, the higher the output of parts from that machine. Now we are, this is the logic that I'm saying, that if I'm using, I'm producing more out of a machine, my OE is higher, right? But is that really needed? I'm not looking at that question. So according to Western mantra, that says only a running machine is a good machine. If your machine has stopped, maybe because of non-availability, down, maintenance, whatever. So it is not a good machine. So it means the corollary of that is a high OE would be good. High OE means my machine is running for much more time without any problem. There are no defects. There is no speed loss. Nothing of that sort. Right? So this is the corollary of this mantra. Only a running machine is a good machine. Now, there is a different philosophy. Produce only what is needed, when it is needed, and in the quantity needed. Now what? Market has slowed down or there are some lows in demand. So, you know, if I'm the smart factory manager, what will I do? I'll keep producing. So what will happen? It could be a disaster for the company because my finished goods stocks will accumulate. There's no demand now. And I'm producing just for it. And when the demand starts coming in, I may not have that thing in the stock. So when I have to produce, only what is needed and when it is needed, from time to time, I may stop my machines. And when I stop my machines, what happens? There is the availability loss. When there's availability loss, what happens? The percentage of availability goes down. When my percentage of availability goes down, the ramification, the devastating ramification is my OEE goes down. And when my OEE goes down, and if my performance is evaluated, my compensation is based on OEE, I lose money. So be aware of this. So live with the new mantra that produce only what is needed, when it is needed, and only in the quantity needed. To show higher OE, I may take big batches. There's no demand, there's no order. But if I had to take small batches, I may have to do sequence setup, and that could be availability loss. Very tempting for me, but that is not good for my company. A high OE without the corresponding customer demand would lead to what? Nothing but overproduction, right? So just having the high OE is not the ultimate thing. You are not running your factory to have high OEs. That could be one of the measures to indicator for you to tell where you are going, but that is not the ultimate thing, right? So don't go feel impressed if somebody says, the set of machines in my department, they are 95% OE. Well, maybe, but that is not the deciding factor. So be aware of high OE also. But this, remember, this doesn't mean that a low OE is better than high OE. Come on, now you know it well. What does low OE mean? What high it means? See, what happens is that once we are given a measurement, we lose sight of what is the goal. What are all the actions that we are taking should be with respect to the achievement of goal. We should be moving towards the goal. We should be helping to move towards the goal. But if the measurement becomes my goal, well, I can do it. And in the process, I will destroy the whole company. Right? So not a high OE or not low OE is the thing that should really matter. By the way, who is paying for inadequate OE? Is your customer paying or you are paying? If customer has to pay by way of your higher prices, he'll go away. So ultimately, you will have to pay. Now we come to our own home pitch, that is theory of consents, right? So OE and theory of consents, right? So how do we look at it? What is the way? As we all know, we have 5 focusing steps at the heart of TOC. So let's look at OE with respect to 5 focusing steps and see how it can be used. So first step, I don't need to tell you, it is identify the constraint. Can OE really help to identify the constraint? How do we identify the constraint? We don't, there are 2 simple ways. One is either we look at where the WIP is piling up. Also, we look at the capacities of various machines, right? So this is what we basically do to find out. But there could be a situation that inventory has piled up almost everywhere. So you don't know which one is. If that is happening, and if your factory is measuring OE, be sure that your OE is big, fudge. And because of OE, you are into this situation. Your people are held responsible to show higher OE, so they just go on producing even if it is not required. So can we really use OE to identify the concern? Perhaps yes, because it will tell us something. It may give us some clue that here the possibility that these couple of machines could be the constraint. Okay, it can tell you. Perhaps I'm not very sure about it. Maybe if you are not able to really find out, you may have a look at OE. Decide how to exploit the constraint. That is the second step that we say. So here probably OE can be of help. You can always find out. You can always find out the availability of your constraint. That is how good your availability is. If it is down, most of the time, if it requires a lot of maintenance kind of thing, you will know. Also, it will tell you about the performance, whether it is, the OE will tell you how good it is running at a higher speed. Is it consistently running at top speed or not? OE will tell you. Also, it will tell you if the parts are getting rejected or reworked or scrapped after after the consult. You know where to pay attention. So here, it might, the various losses that we talked about, it could help us to decide how we want to exploit it. Where to decide, we don't have to eliminate everything. If you find that, whatever rejections are happening and they are very high, they are happening after the constraint has processed the part. So there is some problem, you will want to identify the problem and fix that. Or you find that there is a downtime. Every day there is a couple of hours are lost. Then you will look into the reasons. The reason could be shift change. It could be as small as that. While you are changing the shift and handing over the work, workers might be stopping the machine, cleaning themselves, going to a bath and getting fresh. Then the next fellow comes in, they have a chat, they have a cup of tea, then he tells him what is to be done, and then he starts the machine, perhaps. So that kind of losses, will help you to decide how to exploit the concern. Subordinating, third step, we say that subordinate everything to the above decision. Now, how do we do that actually? And how can we use OE for that? Now, as we know, the performance of the constraint is largely dependent upon the upstream processes. Their job is to keep the constraint busy. Now, they are able to do that because they are non-constrained, meaning by definition, they have spare capacity. They have more capacity. We call it protective capacity. They did that kind of capacity to make sure that the constraint is working all the time. Now, if you have a good measure of OE on such machine, you can really know. And if you feel that protective capacity is just enough, you want a little more. So you will know where to look at in that machine, whether it is not available or it is not producing good part or it is running slow. So for subordinating, it can be of good help if we have very accurate OE of those machines. Well, when you are elevating the constraint, what do? You increase the capacity. You increase it in such a manner. Now, capacity, it is not easy, always easy to increment it marginally. Particularly if you are talking about machines, you may be able to add one or two people if that is required. But if your machine is fully engaged and you feel that that is limiting your ability to perform better, and you decide that now you want to elevate this machine, here again, OE may help you. Because when you elevate your constraint, let us take a simple example. You have a constraint which produces, say, 1,000 parts per day. Now you are elevating it, you are going it for a bigger machine, and you are increasing the constraint capacity from 1,000 parts per day to 1,500 parts per day. Now you have to go back and check the other machine which have the capacity lower than that, or just have marginally more, because you have decided that you don't want to move your constraint. So you need to look at the other machines, look at the future, that once you increase the capacity of this constraint, what will happen to the other machines, right? So that is, again, it can help. So if you look at five focusing steps, it may or may not help to identify the constraint. But if you have a real good measure, it can certainly help you in deciding how to exploit the constraint, in as much as it will give you a pointer to an area to look into and see if this can be improved. When you are at the third step, that is, you want to subordinate everything, you can check at the check the oil to make sure that your protective capacity is intact. On paper, it may look good, but in practice, because of the various losses, it may or may not be adequate. So OE, a good, correct OE can help you in that. To elevate the constraint, certainly it can help you, because when you elevate one machine, it is the capacity of one machine, very likely that you need to elevate the capacity of some other machine. So at that time, if you have good OE for those machines available at your disposal, it will help. See, when you are measuring the OE, the purpose should be very clear to the people. Then and only then you will get a correct measure. So OE could be useful when the constraint is internal. That is what we discussed. So if there is a market demand for your products, but you are unable to cater for it, it could be helpful that we have discussed. See, what happens in real life is that your product mix may change, maybe temporarily, or maybe even permanently, but from time to time, there could be some shifts. It is never that year after year, you sell the same quantity of all your products. No, this change may or may not have impact on your constraint. It may or may not have impact on your non-constraint. So whenever there is a change in product mix, you have to look at the constraint, whether the constraint has moved. And if you find that constraint has not moved, but you are selling certain types of products in more quantities, then you have to look back and look forward to see the machines that work on those products. Because if that quantity has increased, the pressure, the work pressure on those machines also will increase. And as a result, the protective capacity may go down. So when there's a change in product mix, if you have a good measure, good OE, it will help. So use OE data to determine whether you can produce new products or offer some service where the utilization is very low. Now, how come? Now, see, in TOC terminology, we call it free products. They're actually not free, but you have some excess capacity and you can use that. And for some machines, this excess capacity is there, and the parts that these machines produce do not go through constraint. They may be joining the final assembly somewhere, perhaps. So in those cases, when the constraint is not involved and you have excess capacity, fairly large excess capacity, you can do two things, consider two possible things. Think of a product which you can produce by using such machines. That is one possibility. Sometimes it may not be possible. In that case, think of it. If you can insource some work from some other manufacturer who do not have that machine, who outsource that kind of work, your excess capacity, why not? So the idea is to make more and more money. So this is where OE can help you. Then, see, there are bottlenecks everywhere. If you have a fairly large factory, and there are small parallel setups or parallel sets of processes happening, and output of that keeps coming forward. Now, in that, there could be a small bottleneck within that process. The question is whether you really need to improve that bottleneck. Why will you want to improve it? You want to reduce the work in progress. If that bottleneck is slowing down the things, as a result of that, you have to keep larger work in process. You may want to selectively improve such bottlenecks. Now, how the hell can you decide? That is where OE can help you, assist you, if it is correctly calculated. So there are different machines have different capacities. Measuring capacity of individual machine may help, but you have hundreds of machines. Can't say. Measuring OE of the constraint could definitely be helpful. Measuring OE for the factory as a whole and determining the extent of your hidden factory could be a distortion, perhaps. This factory as a whole is not even the average of averages, it is a multiplication of percentages. So, what that number can really tell you It's very difficult to understand that. So, you know, the simple thing, we have to keep the things simple so that, you know, you can use it for bragging and say that, okay, your company has some 10 factories and all factory managers are meeting. You can ask, what do I, come on, tell me, what is your OE? My OE is 87%. You are only 80%, 83%. Come on, I'm far better than you. Only for that purpose. Otherwise, I don't see anything that could be of help. So, does it really matter? Does it matter if individual machines have high or low OE? Okay, does it matter? The answer is, well, it depends. It all depends, because we are not running the machine for the sake of it. We are running the machine because we want to achieve certain goals. So if it has to have low OE, I'm okay with it. If it requires high OE, then also I'm okay with it. Does it matter if the constraint has high or low OE? Certainly. It very much matters. Because it's a constraint. Okay, more that it produces, more the money that you will make. And if the constraint is internal, the quest is to use every bit of its capacity. And the capacity of the whole factory is determined by that weakest link, that is the constraint. So if that is working at the full capacity, you just cannot have very high OE for other machines. You just cannot have. And if you have it, it means it is getting fudged, or you have the capacity is very close to your constraint and you will not know when the constraint will shift. So, where does it matter is important. Where do you use the OE is also important. So, can you really use the OE for a factory level? I don't think so. Now, let's summarize. Use OE as a pointer and only as a pointer to look, to explore, to find out, to inquire. Do not use it for evaluating people's performance. If you do that, you're doomed. It will get fudged. Make sure that it is not fudged or manipulated. How can you make that sure? You have to communicate. Communication is the key. Make people aware of the purpose, why you want to measure OE. If they even remotely think that you are going to measure them, you're going to evaluate them, they are not going to cooperate. Of course, they will give you data, but that will be wrong. But if you tell them, give them the concept, you tell them, look, this is a constraint, every minute of this is important, so I want to know. Or this is non-constraint, but it has very limited protective capacity. So if something goes wrong, okay, constraint will suffer, production will suffer, sales will suffer, so I want to know. If you do that, they will definitely cooperate. Otherwise, if you don't tell them, they are not sure, they don't trust you, so they are likely to forget. In any case, just don't believe in numbers blindly. Believe in numbers. I'm not saying they always tell you lies. But if you are given any OE numbers in our context, ask questions. How availability is calculated, what is included, what is not included, how performance is percentage is calculated, how do you calculate the quality? Ask those questions, understand it well. And if there are any other numbers, see, we treat somehow, you know, we get to believe. A number is something hard fact. They're always, you know, like you are familiar with the number that appears in your bank statement. And you know that is accurate, right? But not all numbers are accurate. That number in your bank statement, you may believe you are blindly. Because you know, that is true. But all other numbers, take it with a pinch of salt, ask questions, then make up your mind to what extent you want to believe, what you want to find out. So see, again, you every time you don't need 100% accurate numbers. You don't need good enough numbers, fairly accurate, more or less correct, may be fine in many cases. But don't go blindly after them. When you see the OE is increasing, you know, you have to start looking at why it has increased. Yet it may not always be a good sign. We have seen one example, when availability was shot up, it increased. But the quality, you came down from 99.5% to 95%. It means there are 5%, almost 5% increase in rejections, defects, scrap. So it's not a good sign, not always. So just because OE has increased, don't feel happy and relax. Monitor how OE is calculated for the constraints. That is critical. You want to exploit the constraint, you must know where there it is losing its time. And you need not even measure OE if you are not really on a mission to improve something. See, first, I agree and appreciate the fact that for some improvements, you need some data. So be specific about that. Tell people why you want to gather this information, gather this data, and then do it. For the sake of it, it's an industry-wide practice. All manufacturers do it. So let us also do it. It has no meaning. So this is what Dr. Goldratt said. Tell me how you measure me, and I will tell you how I will behave. Tell me how you will measure me, and I will tell you what damn stupid things I will do to make the measurement look good. If the measurements are absurd, my behavior will also be absurd. If my performance measurements are not clear, even I will not know how I will behave. So this is what Dr. Goddard had said, and it has a lot of value. Whenever you are looking at any numbers, any performance measurements, if you are setting up some performance measurement, be sure what you are doing and be careful. This is one measure that we have discussed in detail. We have talked about the definition, and I tried to make it attractive by saying that you have a hidden factory. You may not actually have, just because your OE percentage is lower. Just think of one thing. You have one concern in the factory and its OE is higher than 95%. Then do you expect all other machines to have higher OE? You're not likely to. And then when you multiply the percentage by percentage by percentage, it is bound to go down. So don't use it for performance measurement, because it will definitely going to fudge it, and that data will become useless for you. So that is the importance of this. So with this, I close the session. Before I remind you of the various sessions that we conducted so far. And now, this is our today's session, that you are hidden factory, and our next topic.